Welcome back, everybody, to session number 5. I'm Dr. Steve Scheibner.
And I'm Megan Scheibner, and we have covered a lot of ground so far. We have had the practice of modeling and the practice of proactivity, and last week we talked about the practice of consistency. And remember, we said the more you're plugging those character qualities into your children's lives, the less you're going to have to use the fear of punishment to motivate them, because they're going to begin to be motivated by the love of virtue. Now, this week, we're going to talk about the practice of choosing God over self.
Right.
And that's a daily practice, isn't it?
Absolutely.
So, Steve, why don't you get us started, and I'll be back up in a little bit.
I will. I love this session. We're actually almost halfway through, all right? And that's exciting. You know, we've made quite an investment up to this point. The really, really practical stuff now starts in the next few lessons. But this one is a pivotal point in our teaching. And I'm going to share with you one of the major illustrations now that we've been teaching parents for years. And it's one that, again, like the two trees, remember the proactive, reactive tree and how kind of convicting that was for us, right? Well, this one is one that is equally as convicting, because we're going to talk about elevating self and elevating God and what's the difference between the two. Because as parents, and just really kind of as human beings, we make a lot of easy choices that make life harder, when we need to make God-honoring hard choices that make life easier. Now, I'm going to unwrap all that in just a minute. I want to take you to a place that I call the Decision Depot. Because as if you recall, I mentioned earlier in one of the sessions that we make 35,000 decisions a day, right? And each one of those 35,000 decisions we make, we have three major components to go into each one of those decisions. There is our thinking, the brain that God gave us. Can't you hear yourself talking to your kids? Use that brain God gave you, right? So there's your brain. There is your emotions. God gave us emotions and he gave us personalities, right? So those two things are kind of one unit, and we consult and we filter through our personalities. And then finally, we end up with that moral conscience. And I talked about that last time. That shelf inside of us needs to be really well stocked with all sorts of high quality values and virtues and character qualities. If there's nothing on the shelf, we've got problems. All right, we're seeing more and more people like that today. Now, I want you to picture in your mind's eye a giant box store, right? Like a Walmart or one of those box stores. And when you walk through the doors of one of those giant box stores, what do you expect to see shortly after you go through the door? You know, most people go, well, the greeter, the old guy at the door that greets you. I get that. And beyond that, there's the carts. But don't you expect to see a lot of stuff?
Junk,
right? Yeah. And my kids call it the Stuff Mart. And so, because it's stuffed full of things, and there's a certain expectation when you go through the door. Lots of stuff on the shelves, all sorts of people in the store, a lot of energy, a lot of hustle and bustle. Now, what if you pulled up to the box store and walked through the doors and there was hardly anything on the shelf and really nobody in the store? I mean, would that be a little weird? You'd kind of feel, wow, this is kind of strange. So years ago, our little daughter, Molly, who's now all grown up and she's got babies of her own, And Molly was about 6 years old, and we were going to this going out of business sale at one of these big box stores. And how many of you ever gone to a real legitimate going out of business sale, right? Almost everybody. And so it was like 90% off, 3 days left, everything must go. We said, well, let's go see if they've got anything worthwhile. You know, 90% off, how could you go wrong, right? So we walk through the doors of this giant box store, and Megan's on one side and I'm on the other, and we're kind of holding Molly's hands, and she got little pigtails. It was a really cute scene. We walk through the doors of this store, and Molly stops dead in her tracks. She pulls back on both of us. Her eyes get about this big, and she goes, "We need to get out of this place. It's creeping me out." And I said, "Creeping you out?" And she was right. It was kind of creepy. I thought, "Where did you get that?" You know. At any rate, so we spent about 2 minutes in the store. We turned around and we left. It was just a weird experience. Now, what was so creepy to little Molly?
The emptiness.
The emptiness, right? It was so creepy because here's what she was experiencing. She was experiencing the death of a store. Now, I know a store is not a living thing, but it has a certain energy and a certain vibe and an expectation to it, right? And once that's gone, it's like, this is kind of weird, you know? And 3 days later, they bulldozed the whole place and that was it. It was over. And so at any rate, I wanted to take that illustration now about the giant box store and let's apply it to the human condition. We're seeing more and more people these days, just like that giant box store, we're seeing more and more people with less and less on the moral shelf. Morally speaking, character speaking, they're like a going out of business sale. Everything must go, right? And they can't shed their morality and they can't shed their character quickly enough. And so with that in mind, as we're seeing, once you enter through the doors of a relationship with a person like that, you can't quite put your finger on what's wrong and what's missing. But there's something wrong. There's something creepy about the experience. And you get to what I call the Wilbers, right? And you're like, I got to get out of this relationship. And so with that in mind, let's take this now to the decision depot. Because 35,000 times a day, three components come together. Our thinking, our emotions, our feeling, and that moral conscience. All three things come together. And then we make a decision in one of two directions. We either choose to elevate self, or we choose to elevate God. Now, if you're on the page, it says session five on it, and it's virtually blank in the middle. It says Decision Depot Model. I want to take you to the Decision Depot. And again, this is another one of the illustrations that you want to draw out by hand. Again, the character study component that goes with this study for young people, I'm going to encourage them to do the same thing. This is a great piece of paper to tear out of their syllabus, and I'm going to encourage them again in that study to tack it to their bedroom wall. And mom and dad, now you've got a tool that you can use to go point to, and you'll see why in a minute. So let's get started over here on the screen, all right? Here's the Decision Depot at the top, and I'm going to draw a dotted line, and you've got one on your page. And that dotted line represents the outer person and the inner person. What's the difference? Well, we have 35,000 ideas a day, right? And some of those ideas don't see the light of day. They don't go above the line. We keep them to ourselves. They're fleeting thoughts, if you will, right? But once you verbalize on them, act on them, whatever, they go above the line. That's the outer person. Now, out of the heart and mind come our ideas. Our thinking emanates from the heart and mind. And so the two things are synonymous. When I was a pastor for a lot of years, I used to preach that the biggest distance in the universe was between the head and the heart. Well, that preached, but it really wasn't accurate. The head and the heart are actually connected. So as we think and as we feel, out comes our thinking out of this. So draw a little stick figure heart down at the bottom and write the word mind in. And then now that line that's drawn up to this big circle up top, that's going to represent our thinking. All right? So 35,000 times a day, you have these thoughts that come out. And if they go above the line, then they go through three filters. And these three filters are the filter of personality. And they represent three different areas, aspects of personality: the thinker, the feeler, and the doer. Thinkers, feelers, and doers. Everybody falls into one of those categories. And you're probably born very strongly one or the other. All right, Mrs. Scheibner, for instance, is a classic thinker. All right, she's got a brain about this big, and she's got everything lined up inside that substantial brain of hers, just like a set of dominoes. She lines them all up, and when you ask Mrs. Scheibner a question, it's just like you took that first domino and you knocked it over. You have to wait for all the other dominoes to fall, right? So sometimes that takes 20 or 30 seconds. Now, I'll be honest with you. When I was first dating Mrs. Scheibner, and I would ask her a question, her head would tip off at about 20 degrees, and this is what you would get. Just nothing for 20 seconds, right? Why? All the dominoes are falling. I didn't realize what was going on. I thought she was a little slow. So I'd repeat the question, right? That's a bad idea. It's like knocking the dominoes all over again. So now you got to wait. So don't do it again. Don't ask the question. Just wait. They're processing, right? And they'll come back and they'll give you an answer. Sometimes it takes quite a long time for an answer. But, you know, 20 to 30 seconds, Mrs. Scheibner would come back with an answer. What's a feeler? Feelers are those people that are in touch with the interpersonal connection side of things, all right? They feel very deeply and very strongly about things. They want to know that everybody feels accepted. They feel included. They're in touch. They're the natural connectors in life, right? Feelers. What are doers? Doers are idea people. They're dreamers. They have an idea a minute. They can really bowl you over with too many ideas, kind of frustrate other people around them. You ought to see the garage of a doer. It's a disaster, right? Because they love starting things, but they don't like finishing things so much, right? So they've got 12 projects all started at the same time, and none of them finished. I'm a doer. My desk is absolutely just piled high with stuff. Megan's desk looks just like this one right here. Everything is just perfectly placed, right? She's got a little slot for her pencil and all that, because everything's got to be all lined up. So let me pick on thinkers a little bit more, because I'm married to one, and I like to do that. Here's an example of all the dominoes and how they're all lined up, because they're very organized people and everything's got to be so structured. So I'm a doer. I've got the spontaneity gene. I love spontaneous things. Let's not have a plan. Let's just wing it, right? And so I'm driving home dreaming about how I'm going to save the world. I'm thinking, hey, I want to surprise that woman when I get home. So I don't call her ahead of time. I'm just going to spring it on her, right? Because she loves surprises. And so I'm going to come through the door and I'm going to take her out to dinner, right? So I walk through the door, I go, honey, I got an idea. Why don't you drop what you're doing? Let's go out to dinner tonight, right? Now, what woman doesn't want to be taken out to dinner, all right? Am I right about this? Okay. Well, so I watch the head. It tips off at 20 degrees. The mouth goes open, right? I've learned to wait. 20 seconds later, she comes back and she says, no. I'm like, okay, why? She says, well, we have to go on vacation. And I'm like, wait, hold on, Jim. We go on vacation in June, and this is September. I'm not seeing how the two things are connected. All right, follow me with this. Mrs. Scheibner has gotten the meat out to thaw that she's going to cook for dinner that night, okay? And so she can't just waste the meat, so she's going to have to cook it. So to cook the meat means we're going to have to go out to dinner later rather than earlier. If we go out to dinner later rather than earlier, that means that she won't get to the laundry that she was intending to get to tonight. The laundry we call Mount Scheibner because it's just always there in our house, right? And so she's going to have to push that off till tomorrow morning. If she does the laundry tomorrow morning, that means that homeschooling won't get started until 9:30, maybe even 10 o'clock. Oh, wait a minute. We've got a doctor's appointment at 10 o'clock. We can't cancel that. It costs us money. So we got to make the doctor's appointment. So with laundry, I'll have to get pushed to tomorrow afternoon. Wait a minute. We got something else going on tomorrow afternoon, so we won't get to the laundry at all. We might miss an entire day of homeschooling if we stop to do the laundry. If we miss an entire day of homeschooling, we won't get the 175 days in that we need to by law by the end of the year, and we won't be able to go on vacation next June. All the thinkers are going, they're going, yeah? Okay. I'm still back in September going, I'm hungry. All I want to do is go out to dinner. Okay? So that's absolute classic thinker, right? All the dominoes are all lined up. All right. So one more story. A thinker, a feeler, and a doer are at a campfire, right? And the doer comes up with an idea because they've always got ideas. So he says, I got an idea. How about we have some s'mores, right? Don, don't you like s'mores? Right. Well, what do you need for s'mores? You need graham crackers, chocolate, marshmallow, stick, fire, you know, all those things, right? So once the idea of the s'mores is out there, the thinker disappears. Nobody's seen the thinker. Joe the thinker is gone. And where's Joe the thinker? He's out in the woods researching the perfect stick. It can't be too long, it can't be too short, can't be too thick, can't be too thin, it's gotta be just right. So after the research is all done, he comes back with his perfect stick. He's whittling it down at the end to make it nice and sharp. And next thing, Joe's going through the marshmallow bag looking for the perfect TV marshmallow. Once he gets the perfect marshmallow, he puts it on his perfect stick, the perfect distance from the end. He takes it over by the fire. Now he's got it the perfect distance from the flame, and he's rotating it evenly so it becomes an even beautiful golden brown. The children of Joe the thinker are going, Daddy, will you help me with my s'more? Get out of my face, kid. They're totally obsessed with the process, right? They can't see anything else except the process. What's the doer doing all this? Well, nothing is big enough, fast enough, or grand enough for a doer. So the doer is out collecting the history of firewood, right? They've thrown it in the fire. They got the bellows going. They got this big old blazing inferno started. The doer now takes this big old 2x4 of a stick, crams 8 marshmallows on the end, right? Sticks it in the fire. It creates a secondary blaze. At this moment, the doer gets wind of what's going on with the thinker. Not that I've ever done this, but just for fun. The doer casually taps the stick of the thinker. The thinker's marshmallow touches a little ember and whoosh, it lights on fire. The thinker pulls his marshmallow in, whoosh, blows it out, and what does the thinker have to do from this moment forward? Exactly, reset. He's got to start all over again, all right? Now, they always have to go back to the beginning. Now, thinkers don't make very good pilots. Now, I'm a professional pilot, and you're going, wait a minute, I want my pilot to be smart. No, thinkers, feelers, and doers are all smart. They're all off-the-scale smart people, right? But it's the way a thinker processes, they always have to go back to the beginning. If you're in an airplane and the engine catches on fire, you don't have the luxury of going back to the beginning and start. You got to kind of like chop, chop, let's go, right? Remember your mom? My mom used to do that, chop, chop, son, let's go. And so you know, a doer really thrives more in that environment. Back to the campfire. What's the feeler doing during all this? The feeler probably never gets to have their s'more. Why? Because they're making sure everybody else has what they need, and they feel included, and they feel accepted, and they've got a nice thing. They get their greatest joy from making sure everybody else enjoys and gets connected. Now, down at the bottom of your page, I've got some fill-ins here. Because let's make this practical for parenting. Because I'm watching the elbows going right now. You're going, oh, I get it now. The light bulb's going off. You're a thinker. I'm a feeler. You're a doer. Great. Here's the idea with this exercise. You want to be a nice balance of all three. You're born very strongly one or the other. Don't worry about that. That's always going to be there. So with your children, if you've got a thinker child, help them be better feelers and doers. If you've got a doer child, help them to be better thinkers and feelers, and so on. Now, thinkers down at the bottom, if you have a thinker child, they're prone to delayed obedience. They're prone to delayed obedience. And so they will, they love thinking about all the things that they could possibly think about in the universe of thinking. And they just love doing that so much that when you give them a task to do, they just think it to death. And you're like, I don't need you to think about this anymore. I need you to actually do it. So what do you do with a thinker child? Mom and dad, you give them a time frame. A time frame, very practical. Say you have 5 minutes or 10 minutes or whatever you think is time appropriate for the task. And if it's not done in 10 minutes, there'll be a consequence, right? So you're helping them to become more of a doer, right? And even a follow-through doer, which is a really good thing. Now, the next one is this. Feelers are prone to take second-party offense. Feelers are prone to take second-party offense. What is a second-party offense? They'll get offended very easily on your behalf. And let's say you have a really strong feeler friend and something happens and they witness it, and they'll go, aren't you offended by that? You should be. I'm offended by that. I would be very upset about that. You need to be more upset about that. In fact, you need to go tell them something. You know what? I'm going to do it for you. I'm going to give them a piece of your mind. And you're holding your friend back, and you're like, no. You go, look, I'm not upset about this. I'm upset for you. They'll get offended on your behalf. And so sometimes you have to hold back a feeler with some of those things because they feel so strongly on your behalf. When the feeler watches a movie, oh my word. When Benji the dog dies in the end of the movie, it's just horrible. You know, they just fall apart, right? They get so absorbed in things. So they're prone to take second party offense. Again, help your feeler children, and this is not female or male. There's male feelers and female feelers. Help your children to say, you know what? There's an appropriate time to shed a tear. There's an appropriate time for some of these things, and let's get on with it instead of wallowing in the feelings, okay? And the third one is this. Doers are prone to always have a better idea. Always have a better idea. They're going to one-up you in the idea category. And so when you give them a task or an idea or something to do, they're going to want to do it their way, all right? Now, this is a really wonderful thing. These people are going to be the inventors and the CEOs of the future, but when they're 6 years old, it can be an absolute train wreck waiting to happen. So we have a classic doer in our house. He's now 28 years old. And when he was 6 years old, I had just bought that Pergo laminate flooring for my new house. And I had just put it all down. Very expensive stuff, but you can't get it wet. And so we were trying to look for a task for a six-year-old to do. And Megan and I were headed out for about an hour. And I said, get the little Swiffer thing out and Swiffer the floor, right? How can you go wrong with that? A kid can't mess that up, right? Unless he's a doer, right? And a better idea. And so we came back about an hour later and witnessed the scene from the movie Cinderella, where Cinderella is throwing the buckets of water on the floor and the bubbles are going up to the ceiling and they're scrubbing the floor and singing. And all three of the kids, led by the doer, are all scrubbing the floor. And my laminate floor was ruined, right? Absolutely ruined. It cost us a lot of money. But that's a classic better idea. So you have to say, you have to discipline a doer with their ideas and say, no, you do it exactly the way mommy told you. And until you are disciplined at doing exactly what I told you, the way I told you, I'm not going to entertain your better idea just now. All right, don't worry about stepping on their little thinker thing or their little doer thing. It'll always be there. Now, that's thinker, feeler, doer, right? So we go through those three things, and we end up now in the decision depot. And this is where all of our core values and all of our character needs to reside. So mom and dad, have you been planting those seeds over the years, right? Honesty, integrity, love, respect, compassion, responsibility. All those things are there in abundance and good quality. And now we've got the third and final component. All three things come together, and now we choose in one of two directions. We're either going to go to elevate self, or we're going to elevate God. And this happens instantaneously, right? It took me a long time to unwrap this, but it happens instantaneously. Here's the key to this whole illustration. The choices to elevate self are choices that are easy to make, but in the long run, they make life harder. They're the easy choices in life that make life harder, elevating self. The choices to elevate God are choices that are hard to make, but in the long run, they make life what? Easier, right? And so, again, hard choices, elevating God, make life easier.
Well, I hope as you all were watching that illustration, you're remembering what we talked about yesterday with the spiritual muscle memory. And do you see why it's so important that your children have that deeply ingrained into their character? Because these decisions to elevate self or elevate God happen just like that, right? And they need to be so practiced in living out Christ-like lives that their decision is going to be to elevate God. So now I want to get some audience participation right now, because we want to make this practical for you. And what does it look like on a daily basis to make easy decisions that make life harder, or to make hard decisions that make life easier? So I'm gonna ask some questions and just call out your answers, and then we'll discuss them a little bit. So somebody just call out, what's an easy decision that you make in your parenting that really, in the long run, makes life harder? What's an easy decision?
Go to fast food restaurants.
And you know, you're setting yourself up for trouble in a lot of ways, aren't you? Sometimes you kill your budget if you do the fast food restaurant too often. There's the health problems inherent with fast food restaurants. But what about the dynamic of we're a family and we're sitting together? There's something real important about that family dinner table. A lot of our character teaching happens when we're sitting around the table together. And when you're asking your children about their day and saying to them, well, you know, help me understand that choice you made in algebra class today to, you know, get up and run around the room, whatever it is, that's an easy decision that in the end makes life harder. So what's the hard decision? What's the hard decision, you guys?
Make dinner.
Go home and make dinner. And you know what? Sometimes we're just tired. But one of the things Steve taught the boys, and we tell the girls too, is you don't have to like it. You just have to do it. And as we build in ourselves that consistency and that diligence to, you know what, I don't feel like doing the dishes before I go to bed at night, but it makes a difference when I wake up in the morning and the sink is empty. Right, moms? When you wake up with a full sink of dishes, you're already behind, aren't you? And so just learning to, you know what, I don't have to love what I have to do right now, but I have to do it. Okay, what's a hard decision you make in your parenting that really makes life easier? Let them make the bed themselves, yeah. You know, I know something. Moms, you can make the bed better than your children. I think there's not a mom in here who could make a bed worse than their child makes it, right? But when we two things happen. If we go back and redo it, we're saying to them, your effort was not good enough, right? And it takes away their desire, their motivation to continue to make their bed. You know, why make it? Mom's just gonna remake it anyway. Now, why is it important that our children make their bed? We're teaching them little simple principles when we have them do that. The scripture says that we're to do things decently and in order. Making your bed is part of decently and in order. And so when we let them start as toddlers and we say to them, oh, you know, when you make your bed, you pull up your covers and you line up your animals here and it's ready for you now to come back to bed or come back to nap time. We're teaching them that there's a natural order and routine and rhythm to their day. And so that's really important. Making a bed can help them make God look great later. You get it? We're always looking to the eternity. We're always looking to the future. We're not raising children, we're raising young adults, right? We want them to become those godly young adults. What's another one? What's another hard decision you make as a parent that in the end it elevates God and it makes life easier? Tammy?
Denying them privileges when their homework isn't done. You know, something they really wanted to do, but you're saying, no, can't do it.
Yeah, denying them privileges. And we do want our kids to get to do all the fun things, right? But children who learn that they don't have to fulfill their responsibilities and they still get to go do all the fun things of life will become adults who don't know how to do the work they need to do, don't know how to pay the bills before they go spend more money, right? They're living on a hamburger budget and they're going and buying steak. It has long-term ramifications, doesn't it? You know, how about this? What if they haven't finished their work, but there's a really good church activity that night? You know, there's Awana or there's Brigade or it's, you know, Wednesday night children's choir. Would we ever skip something like that because they haven't done their work? I want you to think about that just for a second. Because remember, we want to make a hard decision that elevates God. We always told our children, just because it's a good church activity doesn't mean it's the best thing for you right now, because we care more about your heart, right? The worst night of the week for us as parents was Awana night. Steve was the Awana commander. I was an Awana leader. Our kids knew they had us, right? Mom and dad can't skip Awana. They're in charge. So you know what? I'm going to do whatever I want on Thursday afternoon because they have to take me to Awana anyway. And so Steve and I talked about it, and I said, you know, I'm losing this battle. And there's eight of them. And when our kids realized that there was a battle they could gang up on, you know, we were well outnumbered. And so we talked about it, and we said, you know what, they can go to Awana, but they can sit and watch everyone else. And all those verses they memorized, they can hold on to them for another week. And they can just be there but not be participating. And it took one or two times, and they discovered, hey, it's not so fun to sit and watch everyone else do Awana. And so, you know, we brought some squeezing into their life to help them learn that, you know, you're not going to manipulate us just because this is a good God thing we're going to. So think about those decisions that we're making every day. I want to share a real practical one with you. For those of you who have teenage girls especially, in our culture, we are squeezed every moment when it comes to modesty. Now, as adults, it's difficult, right? As grown women, it's difficult to find modest clothing. For our teenage daughters, it's not just difficult. Their whole culture says to them, you must dress a certain way if you're going to attract attention. And they believe that positive attention from boys is worth it. So we just ran into this incident about a month ago. Our daughter Bailey, and she knows that I share this, and so again, we have their permission to share stories. She's a beautiful girl, and she's a little bitty thing, but she's beautiful. And she had an important student government dinner that she needed to go to. And she put on a skirt and a shirt that were just not modest. But she had a blazer that she put over top, and it made the outfit acceptable because the blazer made it modest. And she left the house, and we thought, okay, she looks okay. Now remember, she's almost 21 years old, so I'm in a different role with her. I'm not in an authority role where I'm saying, here's what you're going to wear. I'm more of a coach, and I looked at the outfit, and I said, well, with the blazer on, you're okay. Now the blazer was a little baggy, right? And heaven forbid that a 20-year-old girl would be wearing something that's a little baggy. And so she got to the dinner, and she wore the blazer through the dinner and through the presentations, but then the time came that they were going to take pictures. And Bailey found herself right here in Decision Depot. She had to make a decision. Was she going to make an easy decision that made life harder in the long run, or a hard decision that made life easier in the long run? And Bailey, when she got to Decision Depot, thought, the baggy jacket just is not that attractive, and she took her jacket off. And so in all the pictures, Bailey was wearing an obviously immodest outfit. Now, we live in the world of social media, right? I knew about the outfit before she was even home. Again, I'm not in that role. I'm not her authority. I'm her coach. So I'm saying, Lord, guard this tongue. Okay, what am I going to say to her? Well, she came home, and Bailey has a young man. And he called her and he said, you know, I saw some pictures about you on Instagram tonight, and they were totally inappropriate. And I'm really disappointed by that outfit you wore. And Bailey went straight to anger and came to me, and how dare he say that? And we began to have a good conversation about it. And we went to Decision Depot, and I said, Bailey, help me understand this decision you made. And she said, well, the jacket was baggy, and you know, it made me look heavy. I'm like, you're 90 pounds. Nothing makes you look heavy, you know? And she said, I made the decision. I didn't think beyond, I just want to look good for this picture. That's where our girls are. And what a struggle it is for them. So moms and dads, you know, we could just come down and say, you must never, ever wear that. Instead, we need to walk with them and say, okay, what's the hard decision? And it is a hard decision. You don't, at 20, 21 years old, you don't want to feel like the girl who doesn't fit in. But you know what? You elevate God when you do that. And you learn self-respect. And that's so important for our girls, so important for them to learn to respect their bodies and to understand that it's not how they look that matters, it's what's on the inside. So for our younger kids, they're going to come to Decision Depot too. And so often our younger kids make the wrong decision just because they don't even know how to slow down for 30 seconds, right? They just jump into these poor decisions because they're running headlong. You know, we have kids that put their toe over the line. And parents, watch out for those kids. And we also have kids that pole vault over the line because they don't slow down for 30 seconds. Actually, they see the line and they consider it a challenge. Here we go, and I'm going to go over this line. You know, Steve and I would say to you, I will take a pole vaulter any day over a toe over the line child, because they absolutely telegraph to you what's going on. And you know, hey mom, here's a line. I'm going to sin. Here I go. Woo! You know, those are the kids that are, they're going to run the world someday. My pole vaulters, I prayed all the time, let them be just as stubborn and over the top for the Lord as they are in disobeying me. It's going to be a beautiful change when it happens. Bring it soon, Lord, or else come, Lord Jesus. But, you know, those are the kids that wear you out all day, but you know what's going on in their hearts and minds. Those toe over the line kids, you have to watch it because they build habits of deceit. Because you think, oh, they're so good, they're so precious, they're always obedient. Look how happy they are, and they never stir up trouble, not like their brother who's jumping over the line. Is their toe over the line? No, they must not know that they're disobeying me, right? And when in the Old Testament, it says when the discipline is slow for a crime, the people's hearts are hardened, and your children's hearts begin, hey, I got my toe over the line. I'm much more concerned about those kids, much more concerned. And my prayer is every single day, and I started praying this when my kids were very, very tiny, God, if there is hidden sin in our home, that's a toe over the line kid. If there is hidden sin in our home, would you please reveal it to me? The problem comes with me because often God reveals it and I'm like, not today, Lord. Do you know, my day planner is so beautiful. We're doing so well. Why do I have to stop and deal with this? But if you pray that prayer, God will let you know, right? And we have been at times stunned by the things that have been revealed in our home, but God wanted us to know, right? But often our kids just, they're heedless. And so they get to that point in Decision Depot where they're either going to elevate self or elevate God, and there's not even any thought that goes into it. So I want to teach you just a really important tool right now that is self-control practice. Now, could you all use a little more self-control in your homes? Yeah. I could use a little more self-control in my home. I'd be built like Bailey if I used some self-control in my home, right? And didn't eat all the time. But we're going to teach you a tool, and that's how I want you to introduce this to your children. But I'm going to call Steve up right now, and we need a couple stools for this illustration. Yep, there's my stool. I'm going to go grab that. And Steve and I don't teach any gimmicky stuff, or we try not to teach any gimmicky stuff. But I will tell you that if you use this tool, if you take the time to teach it to your children, and you teach it just the way I'm going to show you, you almost are going to have gimmicky results, right?
Yeah.
The results are so quick with this, and it's so helpful. So let me set it up for you. You're going to tell your children, and I would say starting at about 12 months. Now, at 12 months, you're going to be, this is a challenging thing to teach, but you can do it. But you're going to tell your children, Mommy is going to teach you a tool, and always refer to it that way. I'm going to teach you a tool that you can use when life seems out of control. When you feel like you just got to touch things or pinch a sister or, you know, your mouth is running, I'm going to teach you a tool that you can use to take what's out of control and bring it into control. So what self-control looks like, here's how we define self-control, is your hands are folded and your mouth is closed. That's a focusing tool for children. For children to fold their hands and close their mouth, they actually have to think about it. Now, some of you, to fold your hands and close your mouths, you might have to think about it too, right? But it takes everything that's busy out here and it brings it under control. And so as I began to teach the tool, I would get two chairs, and we're gonna use two stools today for this. And self-control practice, this is very important. Write this down, underline it, put a star behind it. Okay, self-control practice always involves at least one adult and one child. You can do it with more children, but you cannot do it without an adult doing it also. The adult has to be involved for the whole time. This isn't something to send your children off to do. You are going to do it with them. And so I would say to my children, we are going to sit down in these two chairs, and we're going to fold our hands, and we're going to close our mouths, and we're not going to speak, and we're not going to move around with our hands undone until the timer goes off. Now, all of you have smartphones, right? Timers are so accessible now. When I began teaching self-control practice, all I had was an exercise bike that had a timer on it. That's all I used the exercise bike for. Occasionally, I hung clean clothes on it.
Yeah, right.
But we used it as a timer for self-control practice. And I would say to my children, you sit in your chair, and I'm going to sit here, and we set the timer for 15 seconds. Now, 15 seconds doesn't sound like much, but to a child whose hands are folded and their mouth is closed, 15 seconds is an eternity. Sometimes for mothers who have laundry to do, 15 seconds is an eternity. But I would say we're going to fold our hands and close our mouths. And if they started to wiggle, I would just motion, fold your hands. If they started to talk, I just motioned, close your mouth. And when the timer went off, if they had done well, I was like party mom. Like, you did so great. You are the best self-control practicer I have ever seen in my whole life. Right? I really built them up. If they didn't do well, all I said to them was, well, that didn't go so well. We'll do it again later today. In the beginning, teaching self-control, we did it about 3 times a day. And I would, not when they were in trouble. Never when they were in trouble. I would just say, hey guys, we've got a few minutes. Let's sit down and do self-control practice. When they could do 15 seconds, I upped the timer to 30 seconds. And then we did 60, 90, and then 3 minutes. Hmm. When your child can practice self-control for 3 minutes, they own a tool that they can use anywhere. And I would say that to them. This is your tool now. You own it. And mom's going to remind you now and again that you have this tool that you can pull out. So think of the times that you could use self-control practice with a small child. When you're at a doctor's appointment and you're supposed to go in at 2 and it's 2:45 and you're still in the waiting room and they're hanging upside down by the fishbowl, right? You can say to them, you know what? Let's sit down and you need to use your tool of self-control. At one point, Steve and I had a 3-year-old, a 2-year-old, and a newborn. And we had a Honda Accord. And so to get all the car seats in, Steve would stand on one side of the car and I would stand on the other. And we'd say, go, and we'd slam the doors and it would like vacuum suck the car seats in. But I swear we saved Emma's life by teaching the kids self-control practice because they could touch the baby in the middle, right? And they would be, and so we would say, children, you need to practice self-control. Now, self-control isn't just for little children, is it? Think of your elementary school children that need to practice self-control. Think of your teenagers. We are predominantly a thinker-doer family. Most of our children are thinkers and doers. We have one, and again, it's Bailey, precious little feeler. Bailey cries just for good sport.
Just for fun.
You know, Bailey, why are you crying? I don't know. It just seemed like the day. You know? Takes injustices for herself, for everyone else, you know? And so when her emotions are out of control, we have begun to say to her, and now as an almost 21-year-old, I almost don't have to say it. I say, Bailey, you know what? Your emotions are out of control. You need to practice self-control for a few minutes and then go get into the Word of God. And she has learned that taking that focusing, bringing it all together, and then taking her concerns to the Lord has gotten her out of that cycle of being overly emotional. Though any of you teaching a child to drive, okay? Okay, with my oldest 4 children, I practiced what we call the gasp and grasp method of teaching them to drive, where I would gasp, you know, and grasp the door. And I about ruined our relationship because I would get so uptight with them, right? Now I practice self-control. Our last child who learned to drive was Steven, and he would look over at me and he'd say, you're practicing self-control again. And I would say, you're glad I'm practicing self-control again, because if you knew what I wanted to say to you. Right. So what it does is it takes everything and it brings it under control. Now, the reason it's so important that it has to be a parent and a child doing it together. If you just send a child to a chair and say, fold your hands and close your mouth, that's called a timeout, and that is punishment. That's punishment. That's not a tool that they can use. You want to use that word tool over and over, because really what you're doing is you're saying to your child, I'm giving you something that you can be successful, and then remind them to use the tool. Now, for your littler children, they may get the concept, but you're going to have to come back and revisit it. Every once in a while, say, you know what? We haven't practiced self-control in a while. How about we just a few days now? Let's sit down and practice self-control for a few days. Just make it better. Now, dads, I have a word to you. Because whether you know it or not, you are rock stars in your children's lives. If mom says something, your children will obey it. You know, they'll respect their mother. But when dad says it, it elevates it in importance. You know, it becomes the thing they want to do. And so occasionally when Steve was coming home from work, he would call me and he'd say, how'd it go today? And I'd say, you know, we could probably stand to do some self-control practice. Would you do self-control practice with the children when you got home? And he always graciously said yes. And then I would build it up and I would say to the children, all right, now he knew I was doing this. I would say, your dad's on the way home. And he wants to do self-control practice, and I don't know about you guys, but I don't think he can do it, because I don't think he can even do 15 seconds, because you know how your dad is, and you know, he's kind of a pole vaulter. So they would be all ready, and he'd come through the door, and he'd say, you guys, let's do self-control practice, and they'd say, you're going down, because mom doesn't even think you can do self-control practice. And they would sit down, and they would do self-control practice, and at the end, they'd be high-fiving each other, and jumping around, and mom, you were wrong, dad did it. I'm like, oh, darn, I'm wrong. You know, but when he did that with the children, I didn't have to revisit it for weeks, because it became important. If it's important to dad, it's important to the kids. You fill such a huge role in your children's lives. So back to Decision Depot. We want our kids to be successful. The more you plant the seeds of character, and the more you ask them those good questions, and the more you help them make the decisions that elevate God over self, the quicker they're going to be to do that. Self-control practice is a tool. Catching them being good, noticing their successes just as much, if not more, than you notice their failures, is going to help them long to make the decisions that elevate God. We're coming along and helping our children. We can't do it for them, but we certainly can give them the tools to be successful. Yeah.
Can I say just two things?
You can.
With the self-control practice, if they don't do it, if it's taking a while for them to get it, don't ever punish for this.
Yeah, no.
This is meant to be fun. It's meant to be a game. Reward them if they do it well. Have a little treat or something that's a reward at the end, but don't ever punish for it. And then you mentioned, you know, it started as early as 12 months. Do not put a 12-month-old on a stool or on a chair. This would be in the high chair, okay?
Yeah.
Make sure they're strapped in. Just want to make that clear that you don't, you know, because we're using stools here, don't put a 12-month-old on a stool. All right, but other than that, wonderful.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
All right, so ready to wrap it up?
I think we are.
Okay. I want to encourage you to come to the Going Further, Going Deeper section on this. I'm going to tell you a story that is just incredible. It's very moving, about a hard decision we had to make that made life easier in the life of one of our children. And I think it's going to touch a lot of hearts. So if you got the time, come and join us in the Going Further, Going Deeper section. That's about enough for this session, don't you think?
I think so.
All right, well, with Parenting Counsel You Can Trust, I'm Dr. Steve Scheibler.
And I'm Megan, and we'll see you next time.
Welcome to the Going Further, Going Deeper section now. And as I promised you at the end of the last section, I was going to tell you a story about one of our children. And we have obviously his permission to tell the story, but it's really a moving story. And it weaves in a couple of different elements of the stuff we had discussed earlier, which is Megan and I want to be vulnerable with you and share our failures as well as our successes. So this story has a little bit of failure in it, has a little bit of success, but it really had a great outcome at the end. And as we were looking at that Decision Depot with hard choices that make life easier or easy choices, you know, to elevate self that made life easier, harder. We, as parents, tend to make a lot of those easy choices. This one was a hard choice that we had to make. It's going to fall into that category of elevating God. But a number of years ago, my son, Peter, who is an incredible guy, Peter is a character champion. He's got children of his own now. He is an incredible dad. I have great admiration for Peter. In fact, he's a better dad than I am. And Peter was kind of born to be a dad.
Yeah, he was ready to be a dad when he was five.
He was. When he was just a young guy, he was born to be a dad. And he's excelled at that. But Peter, like all of us, has been a work in progress. And so during those, what we call the turbulent years, you know, when you start to hit some turbulence up at higher altitude, Peter was 19 years old, and he was going to college. The year prior to that, he had gotten a job at the local department store, and they had made him a manager. And in fact, he was excelling at work. He was doing really well. They were giving him promotions and pay raises and all that kind of stuff. But the stuff at home wasn't working out so well, right?
At all.
At all, right? Peter couldn't be bothered to keep his room clean. We had to remind him to do simple things like, you know, brush his teeth and comb his hair. And, you know, some of the entry-level stuff wasn't being taken care of, but yet he was excelling outside the home. And that was rubbing us the wrong way, right? You couldn't quite put your finger on it. So Peter goes off to college. He gets done with his first year of school. He comes back that summer, And they gave him his job back at the local department store. And they made him a manager again. And he's saving up money to go back to school, which was wonderful. And it was actually a double blessing because every June, as now you know, we go on vacation for 2 weeks. And so Peter could be home and take care of the house while we were gone, watch the house, and also mow the lawn. All right, now this is key to the whole story. So before we went on vacation, I reminded Peter probably 3 times to make sure he mowed the lawn at least once and probably twice during the 2 weeks that we were gone. So while we were gone, I called him, twice a week? We talked to him twice a week while we were gone?
Yeah, just checking in.
Each time reminding him about the lawn. Hey, Dad, don't worry about it. The lawn's great. You know, we'll get the lawn. It's going to look fabulous when you get back. And he reassured me. Now, we've had the conversation about the lawn 7 times in total, right? 7 times in total. Do you see where this is going? All right. So we drive home from vacation, 11-hour drive. I get home at about 8:30 at night. The sun is now setting on my lawn. My lawn is about this long, and the weeds and dandelions and everything else. And I got furious. I just get so upset. And so, of course, he hasn't seen the family for 2 weeks, and they haven't seen him. So you know, everybody jumps out of the car. Peter comes running out of the house. There's hugs all around, you know. Peter comes over, and he hugs me, and I'm like an ironing board, like this, you know. And he goes, Dad, what's wrong? I go, what happened to the lawn? Oh, yeah, Dad, the lawn. My wife doesn't understand me. My dog ate my homework. He starts making all these excuses, right? And finally, he says, well, Dad, the lawnmower is broken. It doesn't work. You know, you can't get it to start. I said, what do you bet I go pull the string on that lawnmower and it fires right up? So I went out to the garage and I pulled the string on that lawnmower and it fired right up. And I went out and I mowed the lawn in the dark. I was so upset. I'm swatting mosquitoes, mowing the lawn. It's total silence on the inside of the house. All you hear outside is, you know, and they're waiting for Dad to come in, you know, kind of the impending doom to come back into the house. But while I was out there swatting mosquitoes and mowing the lawn in the dark, which, by the way, was looked awful the next day, right? Yeah, I had some time to think. And so I thought, you know, here's what's bothering me. So I came into the house. I said, Peter, I need to talk to you. Mom, come on, let's go. And we went up. We sat Peter down in the perp chair. Now, I don't know if you have a perp chair at your house. It's the perpetrator chair. It's the chair that all the kids had to sit in when they were in trouble, right? So he sits down in the perp chair. By the way, in our living room today, now the kids are all, most of them are all grown.
Yeah.
They have children of their own.
We decorate with it now.
The perp chair is in our living room. So last Thanksgiving, we had a whole house full of people, and there was not enough seats to go around, so people are sitting on the floor. Nobody is sitting in the perp chair. So I said to the kids, I go, there's an open seat. No. I'm like, you know, you guys can sit right there. No, we're not sitting in that seat.
Flashbacks.
And I looked at them, and I go, why? They go, Dad, that's the chair we always got into trouble in, right? So I totally get that. So we sat Peter down in the perp chair, right? And I said, son, here's the deal. Now watch how I phrase this. I said, here's the dilemma you just handed me. I said, you put me in a rough spot. I said, you want to go back to school in a few months. And I said, I'd love you to go back to school. I said, but you also need me to co-sign your student loan to go back to school. And I said, up to this point, I've been willing to do that. I said, but here's the problem. I said, if I can't trust you to mow the lawn after I've reminded you 7 times, how can I trust you to pay back tens of thousands of dollars in debt? I can't. I said, so you know what? You're more than welcome to go back to school. If you can afford it on your own, great, knock yourself out. I'm not signing your loan. Now look at where we are in Decision Depot. I'm making a hard choice that I know in the long run is going to make life easier. But right at the moment, man, it was hard.
Ugly.
Right? You were upset. He was upset. We were all upset.
Yeah.
This is June. I can't tell you how many times during the rest of the summer I kind of second-guessed that decision. I thought, just sign the loan. Just send him back. But he wasn't making any progress in his character development either. So I said, you know what? Stick with it. Well, September came and went. Peter didn't go back to school. In fact, he stayed home for an entire year. But in that year, he turned that character corner that we were praying that he would turn. He really became a solid guy. And so by the time the next summer came around, I said, son, you know, I'd be more than glad to sign your loan. And by the way, next June when we went on vacation and Peter was staying at home, the lawn was immaculate, all right? It looked like a putting green. It was just perfect
beautiful.
When we came back. It was a beautiful lawn. And so Peter got the message, and that next summer, I said, son, I'd be more than glad to sign your loan. He said, Dad, I'll take you up on that. I signed his loan. He went back to school. So September starts, he goes back to school. About halfway through the semester, it's toward the end of October, I guess, Peter calls me up one night from school. He says, hey, Dad, how you doing? I said, good. He said, Dad, I just want to say something to you. I said, well, what's that? He said, well, I just want to say thank you. I said, for what? He said, well, Dad, thanks for not signing my loan last year. I said, really? I said, why? He said, well, Dad, I've got 3 roommates. He said, they're all freshmen. He said their parents are paying 100% of their school tuition. He said the one kid, his dad bought him a brand new Mercedes automobile. It's his to go to school with. He said they're all flunking out. He said they got the worst attitude. They have no character at all. And he said, Dad, you know what? He said, I got it. I got what you were trying to teach me, and thank you. Now, I can't tell you what that moment is worth. Mom and Dad, it's priceless. That's that moment out of Proverbs 31 where they rise up and call you blessed, right? And it's worth everything. I mean, how long did it take us to get to that moment? Well, if you go back to the hard choice we made, probably about 18 months, it doesn't happen overnight. But really, you got to back it up with 20 years,
yeah.
Right? You know, 20 years of planting those seeds and making hard choices to elevate God above self and in the lives of our children and modeling that for them. It's hard work. But you know what? 20 years later, he rose up and he called me blessed. It just brings tears to my eyes now to think about it. And he's a great guy these days. So I hope that story is somewhat of an encouragement to you. Peter is like all of us. He's a work in progress, but that was probably the final and hardest choice that I had to make as a parent with him, and he was 19 years old at the time. I was a coach to him at that point.
Right.
Now he and I are friends. We'll talk about that progression in a little bit.
Well, and the beautiful thing is now we get to watch Peter making those hard choices with his children.
Yeah.
So we see another generation
right.
that's going to learn to elevate God over right. themselves.
Well, let's finish with some practical
yeah.
applications.
So we wanted to talk about it in this illustration especially, how you live your life makes the difference, parents. And again, this is a parent training course.
Right.
Yeah, you're going to teach your kids, but it's how you live and model that makes the difference. So how do parents model this growth? How do they model making the hard choices? How do they model elevating God? We're going to give you three kind of steps for it. And the first is this: through personal growth and accountability, you absolutely have to be growing in your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. We can't teach you something that is a magic pill that will undo the problems that come about if you are not growing personally.
Yeah.
So are you in the Word of God? Are you in prayer? Are you memorizing the Word of God and hiding it in your heart so it protects you from sin? Are you fellowshipping with other believers? Are you teaching your family to serve? All those things that cause us to grow in our relationship with Christ, they model for your children how they can grow and begin to make the hard choices. And who are you accountable to? You know, sometimes we end up being like an island. We don't answer to anyone. Sometimes our children are the right people to be accountable to.
Right.
You know, I told you that my reactivity has to do with a harsh tone. And when I gave my children the freedom to say to me, Mom, the tone you're using is hurtful. I hated hearing that from them so much that it caused me to bump it up and to really work on that and to take seriously the damage I was doing with my tongue. So that's step number one. Step number two is transparency and vulnerability. If we try to portray to our children that we are super Christians, you know, that we have no problems and, you know, well, let's pray about your problems, kids, but Mom and Dad, we're kind of above it. We don't really have any problems. You know, we need to be vulnerable with our children and say to them, you know, this is an area I'm struggling in. I have said to my children, I am weary with disciplining you. And I'm afraid that I'm going to do it wrong because I'm so tired. There have been times that I've had to say to my children, I would love to deal with this issue right now, but I need you two to wait out here and I need to go talk to God because otherwise you're going to get Mom and I want you to get Jesus.
Right.
And so we need to be transparent and vulnerable with our children. Now, obviously, there are things that go on in our adult lives that are too heavy for our children to
right,
bear.
Right.
And we shouldn't be vulnerable about those things. And Steve, maybe in another session, you can share how we taught our children about those burdens that are too heavy to bear. And the suitcase,
sure.
teaching
yeah.
them what's too heavy.
Absolutely. Well,
Go ahead and do it now.
Sometimes kids will ask you stuff that's kind of, it's not age appropriate yet. The classic one is, you know, where do babies come from, right? And the little child will ask you that. There is a time to tell children where babies come from, but if a six-year-old asks you that, the answer to them is, well, that's something we'll get to someday, but that's a burden that's a little too heavy for you to carry. Let Mommy and Daddy carry that for you right now, and we'll get to that sometime down the road. And they'll be like, okay, and they'll go off to the next thing, right? So it's not that you're trying to skirt the issue, it's just that it's not age appropriate.
Yeah, and with some of our kids, Steve filled a suitcase that was literally too heavy for them to carry, said pick it up, and they couldn't,
yeah.
and then he picked it up, and he said, this is what it looks like. There are things that Mom and Dad need to carry.
Right.
So as you're being vulnerable and transparent, be careful that you don't go beyond their innocence, right?
Yeah.
But they need to know that we struggle too. Until the day we go to be with the Lord, with our children, we're going to be fellow strugglers.
Absolutely.
And then here's the third one, consistency and standards. You know, parents make hard choices as they are consistent in the standards they set. And this, remember, the standard remains the same for your entire family. How you get there may look different for each child, may look different for you as a parent, but you need to hold that consistent standard first out of honor for the Lord Jesus Christ. If God has impressed a standard for your family, then you need to act in obedience. But second, because of the security and the parameters it provides for your children, makes your home and your family relationship a safe haven for them.
Right. Now, another family might have a different standard than your family.
Absolutely.
That's that proverb that says, pay attention to your herd and your flock. That's the one you got to account for. So don't worry about what everybody else is doing. Don't be that sheep parent that says, well, but they have a different standard and they've got a different standard. We think our standard is better than theirs. No, no, worry about yours. Set your own family standard. We always said we are the Scheibners. Others may do this, but the Scheibners do X, you know? And so we had our own family standard. We didn't also try to make ourselves superior with that, right? We should be very humble in that process. And you know what? If somebody has a different standard than you, maybe it's about movies that they watch that you don't watch or whatever, uphold their standard.
Oh,
it's
absolutely.
Okay. Even if, especially if they have a more stringent standard than yours. Don't try to tear it down and belittle it. Just, you know, uphold it.
Yeah, right? I often told our children, perhaps God knew that their family didn't need this standard. He knows our family needs it because he knows our sin appetites.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know? And so as we make those hard choices and as we model it, number one, we're going to grow in our relationship with the Lord. And that's exciting. You know, I don't want to stop growing till the day I step into eternity. But number two, our children are going to see what it looks like to live a life that is just surrendered to the Lord Jesus and willing to make those snap, elevating God decisions.
Right. Well, that moment where they rise up and call you blessed is absolutely worth it. It doesn't happen by mistake. It doesn't happen in a vacuum. It happens as a result of good parenting over a long period of time, planting those seeds, watering the garden. Don't trample on it too much. And mom and dad, don't be afraid to make hard choices that elevate God when you need to. But be patient. It may take a while for them to turn around and call you blessed, but they will. And it is worth it.
Absolutely.
All right. I think that's enough for this going deeper session.
Me too.
Well, with Parenting Counsel You Can Trust, I'm Dr. Steve Scheibner.
And I'm Megan, and we'll see you next time.